The songs and worship this morning will be all about Jesus as our King. And I'm going to read a little something that I didn't write, but it's pretty good. You probably know life is full of changes. But if you only think about how your life is always changing, it can make you feel uncertain and worried about your future. Let this truth give you courage and hope for your future. Your God never changes. He's always faithful, always with you. He always loves you, and he's always in control. There's no challenge he can't help you through, and no problem too big for him to solve. Take joy in knowing that the one who is always king is also the one who is always with you, and that fact will never change. You can stand with me while we sing this next song. Hosanna, you're my King.
Hosanna, you're my King.
I worship and I sing.
I worship and I sing.
I lift your holy name upon high. I worship and adore.
I worship and adore.
Sing praise forevermore.
Sing praise forevermore.
Hosanna, you're my King.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Wow. I want to welcome you to worship this morning, and if you're a guest or if you're watching online, and a special welcome to you. We are a family of believers. We want to boldly show Jesus, to love God, and to love others because God loved us first. As you come in, you should have received a bulletin, and it'll give you some information about our worship today, and on the back, information about our family life throughout the week. But at the bottom, there's a connection card. We'd like you to fill that out and put that in the collection plate. And if you're a first-time visitor, if you take that to the information kiosk in the lobby, we'll have a small gift of thank you for coming to worship with us. And if you've been visiting with us for a while and you're thinking about becoming part of our family, you can indicate that on the connection card, or if you have prayer requests that you would like to note there, you can do that as well, and that will get to the leadership and the elders, and we will take care of that. My name is Steve Watkins. I will be the elder in the office for part of the morning. I'll be in the office throughout our worship, and then I have the second graders, where are my second graders, for Bible class, and then Rick Bather will be in the office. And we're there for prayer. If you have anything that you want to talk about, or you need prayer or conversation, or if you want to just bring us a cup of coffee, we'd appreciate that too. But we will be in that area there to serve you. So this week I was shocked and completely heartbroken by the tragic event in Christchurch, New Zealand. I remember not too long ago, I was up here talking about racism, and now again, we have another tragic event. Without the salvation and the merciful love of Jesus Christ, man's evil nature is to seek out and blame others for whatever their apparent injustices are in their lives. We know the mystery of Jesus Christ. We know that love and we know that mercy, and it is upon us to share the good news of Jesus. We as Christians are called to overlook the outward differences and to not show favoritism or partiality, but to love one another, even our so-called enemies. So as we approach the throne, and then when we leave here, please remember that we carry a very awesome responsibility, and that is of sharing the good news of Jesus Christ, reflecting the love and the mercy that God has given us through his son Jesus to everyone that we meet. So as we approach the throne of our sovereign King, please stand as we read God's word for our call to worship. This is from 1 Chronicles, chapter 29, verses 11 and 12. Yours, O Lord, is the greatest, and the power, and the glory, and the victory, and the majesty. For all that is in the heavens and in the earth is yours. Yours is the kingdom, O Lord, and you are exalted as head above all. Both riches and honor come from you, and you rule over all. In your hand are power and might, and in your hand is to make great and to give strength to all. Let us continue singing praises to our God.
Going to Calvary, where Jesus bled. Sealed
sing this next song, I'm going to read another thing that I didn't write, and you can be seated. It goes really well with the next song, You Are My King, Amazing Love. When we say in faith to the God who loves us, Lord, not my will, but yours be done, we uncurl our fingers. Our rapid heartbeat and fretting words slow to a quiet. We soften and take on a posture that is free to remember that our God wills what's best for us and always has. Jesus, whose will it was to die in our place, is in charge of all things and holds them all together. Colossians 1:17 says, and he is before all things, and in him all things hold together. So when my friend worries that her baby will be deaf, we can sit together and remember God's mercy at the cross. When my other friend is wrecked with anxiety over her son's self-harm, we can remember that Jesus rose from the dead. When I panic because my brother has not yet surrendered to the Lord, I can remind myself that God has proven to be trustworthy time and time again. And after we remember, we can ask with authenticity that his will be done on earth as it is in heaven, because we know that his will is very, very good. The hands that hold our future are the same hands that were pierced for us. I'm forgiven because you were forsaken. I'm accepted. You were condemned. I'm alive and well. Your spirit is within me because you died and rose again. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? It's my joy to honor you. Amazing love, how can it be that you, my King, would die for me? Amazing love, I know it's true. It's my joy.
Good morning, church.
Good morning.
So this past Christmas, my better half, Rachel, she had gifted me the DNA ancestry kit. And as it turns out, I am 67% English, 29% Irish and Scottish, 3% Swedish, and 1% Greek. Now, the previous Christmas before this past one, I'd gifted Rachel the same DNA kit. And her highest percentage was only 39% Cameroonian. The rest was scattered across the globe in 12 different areas, from the Philippines to American Indian. She's basically from everywhere, so right now she's in the back prepping to teach the kids, but if you see her later, say hi to her, because you might be related to her if you go far enough back in your family line. So. She's from everywhere. So the truth is, each of you are single individuals, but you're also the genetic makeup of a multitude of generations before you. All those intricate details of your face, like your eyes, your ears, your nose, your chin, are all genetic puzzle pieces of people that you know, like your family members, and people you've never met from the past. And as individuals, we tend to take on an individualistic mentality of me and Jesus. We get so tied to our personal lives, our 9-to-5s, our jobs, our family, that we lose sight of the bigger picture. Biblically, Christianity is personal, individual, and intimate. But it's not meant to be private or individualistic or isolated. As children of God, we are also family members of the body of Christ. And even as we rejoice in our personal relationship with God, let us not forget our family relationship God has given us in this body of Christ. Please join me in prayer over the bread. As we take this bread, let it be a reminder of the sacrifice you paid for us as individuals, for our families, for the generations of people before us, and for humanity as a whole. In your name we pray. Amen. When you think about all the generations of people it took to make up the physical person that you are today, when you think about all the people that make up Christianity, and you think about humanity as a whole, every one of us has fallen short in sin. Jesus shed his blood for our combined sins so that we could receive grace and forgiveness. Think about how massive of a cost he paid for us. Please join me in prayer over the cup. Thank you, Jesus, for your sacrifice. Through the blood you shed, we have the opportunity to live with you not only here on earth, but in heaven. As we take this cup today, let it be a reminder of the tremendous sacrifice you paid for humanity. In your name we pray. Amen. This is the time in our service where we do the offering. So if you're a guest today, don't feel that you must give. Giving is something that God wants us to do sincerely from our hearts. As a member of this church, I know that every dollar directly helps ongoing efforts here in this church, in the community, and in multiple missions throughout the world. Each of us here have different abilities to give. And it's not the act of giving that's truly important. It's what's in your heart, regardless of whether you give 50 cents or $50,000. It's a faithful act between you and God that benefits many. Please join me in a prayer over the offering. Lord, we come to you in prayer over this offering today. Please allow each member to examine their hearts as they give this morning. Let us all take gladness in this act of faith, as we know it's truly helping further God's kingdom. In your name we pray. Amen.
Good morning and welcome to Fairfax. I'm Matthew Windham. Thank you for being here with us this morning. If you're visiting with us, welcome to our family. If you've been coming for some time or are already part of our family, welcome back. We are a family of believers who want to boldly show Jesus, to love God, and to love others because God first loved us. The Women's Retreat is coming up on March 29th and 30th. Galatians 5 tells us that it is for freedom that Christ has set us free. But what does freedom look like? It's going to be a tremendous weekend filled with song, testimonies, and a powerful reminder to stand firm in the freedom of Christ. The weekend will feature our very own Dr. Andrea Morris sharing how freedom in Christ gives you victory over bondage. And Candace Strother speaking on how you can live free every day in the abundant love of Jesus. The cost is $20, which includes meals and childcare. Registration is now available through our website. Once again, that's March 29th and 30th. The Fairfax 50th anniversary is just 2 weeks away. We are nearing the final preparation to celebrate how God has worked through this family to boldly show Jesus. If you haven't done so already, please register for the weekend, even if you can only come for part of the time. This will ensure that you have been covered for any meals and that you get a t-shirt. You can register online through our website. The elder reaffirmation process for Ray Bingham is still underway. If you didn't get a chance to join in last week, next week will be another opportunity to affirm on paper. Online is also available through next Sunday. Once again, I'm Matt. Thank you for worshiping with us at Fairfax. Have a wonderful morning.
Our reading this morning from the Bible before the sermon will be from the book of Judges, chapter 2, verses 10 through 17, and then the final verse in the book of Judges. After that generation died, another generation grew up who did not acknowledge the Lord or remember the mighty things he had done for Israel. The Israelites did evil in the Lord's sight and served the images of Baal. They abandoned the Lord, the God of their ancestors, who had brought them out of Egypt. They went after other gods, worshiping the gods of the people around them, and they angered the Lord. They abandoned the Lord to serve Baal and the images of Ashtoreth. This made the Lord burn with anger against Israel, so he handed them over to raiders who stole their possessions. He turned them over to their enemies all around, and they were no longer able to resist them. Every time Israel went out to battle, the Lord fought against them, causing them to be defeated, just as he had warned. And the people were in great distress. Then the Lord raised up judges to rescue the Israelites from their attackers. Yet Israel did not listen to the judges, but prostituted themselves by worshiping other gods. How quickly they turned away from the path of their ancestors who had walked in obedience to the Lord's commands. And then the last verse, which is really a summary of the entire book, says this: In those days, Israel had no king. All the people did whatever seemed right in their own eyes.
All right, if you are a child, at this time, you are dismissed to children's worship. And if there's any indication from the reading this morning, it's not a good lesson for children to listen to anyway. So kids, you're dismissed at this time. I want to start by thanking Dave Palmer. Dave asked me to come preach this morning. It was his slot. And one of the things that Dave says is whenever you're leading people, you have to think about who you're bringing along with you. And so, Dave, I'm happy to walk beside you, behind you, wherever you want me, man. Thanks for having me up here. He's also really smart, because if there's one lesson to punt, it's probably this one. Judges is a terrible book. I don't mean that the Word of God is terrible, but terrible things happen in the book of Judges. It starts terrible, it ends terrible, everything in between is terrible. It's like the early days of reality television. Any of you guys remember those? Not like it is now where, you know, someone overcomes some type of tragedy and then, you know, they go in front of a group of people and they display this talent and, wow, that's just amazing to see. And they're crying, the judges are crying, you're crying, I'm crying, we're all crying. No, we're talking about reality TV, you know, birthed from the cesspool of 1990s MTV where you're watching people train wreck their lives. You don't want to watch, but you can't look away, and the more you watch, the worse it gets. That's the book of Judges. Welcome to church, Fairfax. So, we're left here to wrestle with quite a few questions. But first, we need to do an overview of the book of Judges. So we'll pull up slides here in a second and look at some of the judges that have been mentioned in this book. But you need to know that Dan has already basically told you the book. There's a cycle that's explained here. Israel falls away from God, worships the other gods of the Canaanites, the people they're supposed to drive out, and they didn't. As they fall away, God allows them to be subjugated to other kings, other rulers within the Canaanite area, the Canaan area. And then they cry out for help, they repent. God ultimately decides to give them a judge to save them. The judge saves them through the power of God. They're saved, they have a time of peace, and then eventually they fall away again. The cycle continues. Each verse is worse than the one prior to it. Okay? So that's what's going to happen. So let's go ahead and pull up the slides here and look at the sets of judges that we're going to have. So the first one that we read about is a guy named Othniel. This is Caleb's brother. Caleb, as in Caleb and Joshua, one of the spies that went to see Canaan the first time. Now we read in chapter 1 that Caleb's brother Othniel accepts a challenge from Caleb. See, Caleb's trying to drive out a Canaanite town called Kiriath Sefer, and he says to everyone there, he says, whoever drives out the people in Kiriath Sefer will gain the hand of my daughter in marriage. So Othniel, seizing the opportunity to marry his niece, rises to the challenge and overthrows Kiriath Sefer. That may sound a little weird to you, but keep in mind we're only in chapter 1. He's not a judge at that time. In chapter 3, he becomes a judge because Israel ultimately falls away, and they look for a warrior to save them from the Aramites. And once again, Othniel's called upon. He overthrows Aram. Israel knows peace. Repeat the cycle. Next one is Ehud. A lot of you guys have probably heard of Ehud. This is just a great story. He's the one that was left-handed. He tricks the king of Moab, Eglon, to have a secret meeting with him so he can give a secret message from God. So he gets alone with King Eglon. He pulls the sword from the opposite thigh that the guards didn't check because he's left-handed, stabs Eglon in the belly, and we're told that the King Eglon was so fat that his belly swallowed up the handle of the sword. Good stuff, right? Then we go to Deborah and Barak. So Deborah's the judge, and Barak is her general. And she is tasked with driving out the Canaanites who are under King Jabin and his general, Sisera. And Deborah tells Barak, the time has come. God wants us to drive these people out. He'll deliver them to us. And Barak says, I'm not going to go unless you go with me. And if you don't go, I'm not going. And Deborah says, okay, but if that happens, then a woman's going to get glory for this victory and not you. Barak's fine with that. They go, they fight the Canaanites under King Jabin. They get everybody except Sisera. Sisera's able to escape, and he escapes to what he thought was a friendly encampment. And we meet a lady named Jael who coaxes Sisera to come rest in her tent. And she's going to keep everyone away so that he doesn't get killed. She's going to trick them into the Israelites into going somewhere else to find him. And while he's sleeping, she takes a tent spike and drives it through his Sisera's temple with a hammer. So this is HBO level reality TV right here, as you're seeing. And it only gets worse. Gideon, you might have heard of. Gideon's the one that he needed a lot of signs to be assured that he was the right person to lead Israel out of their subjugation. And he gets, I think, 3 or 4 different signs. And ultimately, God delivers Midian, or delivers Israel from the Midianites by reducing the number of Gideon's army to just 300 people so that God gets the credit and Gideon doesn't. And if the story ended there, that'd be okay, but it doesn't end there, because Gideon gets into a petty argument with the towns of Succoth and Peniel on his way to get the remnant of the Midianite army that had fled. You see, he asked the towns of Succoth and Peniel, "Hey, we're tired from all this battle. Can you give us some bread so we have some energy to finish off the rest of these Midianites?" Both of these towns told him no. And so Gideon says to the town of Succoth, "Okay, since you said no, when I finish driving out the Midianites, I'm going to come back here and rip you to shreds with thorns and briars." And he tells the town of Peniel, "When I come back from finishing off the Midianites, I'm going to kill all the men in your town." And he does those two things. And he didn't need a bunch of signs from God to do that. He was very confident to do that one. Looking next, we're going to go into Jephthah in more detail a little bit later, so I'll skip over him for the moment. Samson we probably know the most about because there's the most written about him. And I won't read through all that, but sex and violence, that's what happens with Samson. Lots of it. 3 different acts, or 3 different women, 3 different instances of mass slaughter of people. If there's anything redeeming about Samson, it's not easy to see. He asked for faith one last time at the end of his life to push down pillars and kill a big group of Philistine leaders. But there's not a lot of good going on there either. And Judges ends with 5 chapters of no ruler at all. In fact, in 4 of the last 5 chapters, we see this line that Israel had no king. And the spiral's even worse than what I've just told you. The book of Judges ends with a horrifying act of sexual violence resulting in murder. And then that whole act turns into a civil war that breaks out among the tribes of Israel. And the overarching thing that we have to keep in mind as we look in any part of Judges is, if you don't have a king and you do what's right in your own eyes, it's catastrophe. And as Steve kind of mentioned this morning, since he mentioned it, I'll follow up on it. You know, the shooters of the mosques in Christchurch, they had a manifesto where they quoted Matthew as a reasoning for why they did what they did. You know, most people think that they're doing right in their own eyes, and we just see here in the book of Judges and in our culture around us the ramifications of that. So Judges is a warning. If we go ahead and look at the story of Jephthah, we'll go to the next slide here. We're going to spend a lot of time in here because, like a reality TV show, just because we know how it's going to end, we got to watch the train wreck. We got to dig deep on this one. I didn't want to talk about Jephthah. When Dave asked me if I wanted to talk about Judges, I knew I had to go here, because this is a story that wrestled with my faith. And this, I wouldn't say it almost pushed me away, but it took me a long time to recover from this story. And I just thought it would be appropriate to try and lean into this and share just some conclusions that I came to in hopes that that helps you too. And if I end up wrecking your faith sharing this story, I'm sorry, but just know that God's bigger than this. So let me give you a little bit of background on Jephthah before we go into the word a little deeper. So Jephthah was born in a land called Gilead, and his father's name was also Gilead. I don't know if that's just coincidence, but anyways, his father's name was Gilead, and his mother was a prostitute. So right off the bat, you get a good old-fashioned Judges start to a story. So Gilead also had a wife who bore him sons, and ultimately those sons, or Jephthah's half-brothers, did not want any part of Jephthah at all, and they sent him away. And Jephthah fled to a land of Tob. He became a warrior type. He was known for being a mighty warrior, and so other rough-around-the-edge warrior types decided that they wanted to band together and be around Jephthah as well. So he was known for that. In the midst of all this, Israel once again falls away from God. And so the elders of Gilead need to find a warrior to deliver them from the Ammonites. And the best person they have is Jephthah. So they go and they approach Jephthah, and they say, "Hey, come help us drive out the Ammonites, and you will be our leader." And rightfully so, Jephthah was pretty dubious. He said, "Will I really be your leader if I drive out the Ammonites?" And they said, "These people are our witnesses. Yes, you will be our head." So Jephthah says, okay. He tries to negotiate with the Ammonites. It goes nowhere, so he's going to go fight. So let's pick up here in the next slide. We're going to read Judges 11, starting in verse 29. "Then the Spirit of the Lord came on Jephthah. He crossed Gilead and Manasseh, passed through Mizpah and Gilead. From there he advanced against the Ammonites. And Jephthah made a vow to the Lord, 'If you give the Ammonites into my hands, whatever comes out the door of my house to meet me when I return in triumph from the Ammonites will be the Lord's, and I will sacrifice it as a burnt offering.'" He devastated 20 towns. I'm sorry. "Then Jephthah went off over to fight the Ammonites, and the Lord gave them into his hands. He devastated 20 towns from Aroer to the vicinity of Minnith, as far as Abel-Karim. Thus Israel subdued Ammonites." When Jephthah returned to his home in Mizpah, who should come out to meet him but his daughter, dancing to the sound of timbrels? She was an only child. Except for her, he had neither son nor daughter. When he saw her, he tore his clothes and cried, "Oh no, my daughter. You have brought me down, and I'm devastated. I've made a vow to the Lord that I cannot break." "My father," she replied, "you've given your word to the Lord. Do to me just as you promised, now that the Lord has avenged you of your enemies, the Ammonites. But grant me this one request," she said. "Give me 2 months to roam the hills and weep with my friends, because I will never marry." "You may go," he said. He let her go for 2 months. She and her friends went into the hills and wept because she would never marry. And after 2 months, she returned to her father, and he did to her as he had vowed, and she was a virgin. Dave, I'm in over my head here, man. You should have taken this one. All right, let's get the first reactions out of the way. First reaction, Jephthah, what are you thinking? Why do you even offer a vow? It wasn't even necessary. God was going to deliver the Ammonites into your hands. Why do you make this vow? And it's a terrible vow. Why would you vow that someone else would have to pay something to show your righteousness? And what did he expect to come out of his door? That's not going to be an animal. A door, you know, there's no, a cow's not going to come out of your house to greet you after victory. It's going to be a person. What are you thinking? And then we start thinking, well, why does God allow this to happen? I mean, yes, this is Jephthah's fault, but God can do something about this. You see, one of the reasons that God wanted the Canaanites to be driven out is because they practice human sacrifice. It's the most detestable thing to God. Why didn't God do anything about this? We read a few chapters later, and Samson, he does a really petty thing where he has a riddle that he doesn't want his wedding party to solve while he's going to get married to a Philistine woman, the first one, not Delilah. And we're told that when they guess that riddle, because the groomsmen ultimately pressure Samson's wife to share with them what the riddle is, Samson is so angry that she shares the riddle with him that the wager of this riddle was whoever gets the riddle right gets 30 pairs of clothes, 30 sets of clothes. And so we're told the Spirit of God comes upon Samson so that he can go into a neighboring town. He kills 30 people, steals their clothes to fulfill a vow to the wedding party. So the Spirit of God was with them on that. The Spirit of God didn't seem to intervene here for Jephthah's daughter. And we start asking all these terrible questions about how do we wrestle with this story of Jephthah and his daughter, and it just gets worse and worse. And we need to remember the theme of the book of Judges whenever we try to apply what's happening here with Jephthah and his daughter. You see, whenever we do what's right in our own eyes, catastrophe happens. And what I'm doing right now is trying to do what's right in my own eyes in regards to my faith, by trying to make sense of this story and trying to place it with what I understand about God to be good and to be holy. And we need to establish an essential ground truth here. And that truth is that you and I are not able to discern matters of good and evil without God. Period. And we can establish this baseline truth by going all the way back to Genesis 3. Remember Genesis 3 where where the serpent is tempting Adam and Eve? You ever wonder why that tree's there? I mean, to start, I assume it's there because, well, we have to have free will. There has to be something, some opportunity to sin against God, because if there's no free will, then there's no true love. And if there's no true love, well, then what is God? So we needed to have a tree there in order for God to be who he is, right? But what was he actually trying to protect us from? The tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Because think about that. What the serpent said was half true. We didn't die. Eve didn't die when she ate the fruit. Serpent said, surely you won't die. You'll be like God if you eat this. And Eve didn't physically die. We know that ultimately God meant a spiritual death is what's going to happen. And then the other half of that is you'll become like God if you eat the fruit of this tree. And that's kind of true too. We're not God just because we know what good and evil are, but we try to take on his responsibility, don't we? When we try to adjudicate between good and evil. And look what happened. Look at the rest of human history. If I think I'm right, if you think you're right, the only way for me to enforce my righteousness is to say that you're right is actually evil. And we just keep going back and forth and back and forth. And we act like a bunch of people doing right with what's right in our own eyes. And we have no king to tell us otherwise. And it's catastrophe. And so come back here to Jephthah. And this may not be a good enough explanation for you guys, and I respect that. But for me, I don't have the authority, and I don't want the authority, to judge what's good and evil here in the story of Jephthah. And I have to make a choice to lean into the rest of what I know to be true about God's nature. To say, is he a good God? Is he who he says he is, that he can reconcile this section of scripture so that my heart can handle it? And if that's an acceptable answer for you, and eventually, after a while, it became acceptable for me to lean into God despite what we read about in Jephthah. If that's acceptable to you, you still have to wrestle with really the whole book of Judges, but particularly here. What's the hope in this? Why is this even here? What do I learn about the nature of God through this passage? Because this isn't the last thing we hear about Jephthah. I mean, if it ended here, at least we could say, well, he's a man of his word. It's a noble thing that he tried to do, but it doesn't end here. After he does what it sounds like he did to his daughter, he gets into a petty argument with the tribe of Ephraim, because they were upset that Jephthah didn't invite them to go fight the Ammonites. And ultimately, it results in a battle between those two, and he wipes out a fair amount of Ephraimites. And that's where the story of Jephthah ends. So how do we find hope in this? And I'd like to go to the next slide. We'll look at Hebrews chapter 11, because that wasn't the last time we hear about Jephthah. Thank God. In Hebrews chapter 11, you'll recall, this is the hall of faith. These are the titans of Israel's faith story. You know, you got Abraham, you got Isaac, Jacob, Moses. And then there's this little nugget in here. Look at verse 32. What more shall I say? I don't have time to tell about Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah. God, you got the wrong guys in there. Right? I mean, if you pick any judges, it would maybe be Othniel, Ehud, and Deborah, but not these guys. They might have had one moment of faithfulness, but that's it. Everything else was a train wreck. We saw it. Why are they in here? And I think what we take out of this is in Hebrews 11, it's not about the people who are in there. It's about God. It's about who God's willing to work through in order to reach his people, in order to save his people and keep his people. And if God can work through the lives of Gideon, Barak, Samson, and Jephthah, what can he do through your life? What lengths is he willing to go through for you if he's willing to redeem the train wreck that was Jephthah's situation? And flip it around, too. This also means that anyone in this world is one faithful decision away from God being a redeeming force through them. So now I can't righteously call out someone else and say that they're evil unless God helps me make that determination, right? So someone can have a different theological position than me. Someone can have different political views than me. Someone could be richer than me, poorer than me, smarter than me, dumber than me. God can work through that person. And that's part of his story. And that person can show up in Hebrews 11. So who am I to say whether they're good or evil? I don't want to be a part of that decision. Another thing that comes out of Hebrews 11 is how is faith actually passed down from generation to generation? Because that's the topic that I'm supposed to be talking about here. But Judges is a really hard text to work from to do that. So in Hebrews 11, by someone like Jephthah being in here, we can kind of relate to it. Because Jephthah's family line dies with him and his daughter, we're told, right? But yet he has a legacy that was important enough to be written about here in the book of Hebrews. Why is that? I think it's because of the same legacy that we want to be able to pass on to our kids. You see, when we put on Christ, we're declaring through our baptism that we are dead, that we want Christ to live through us and to act through us, do everything that God wants to do to build his kingdom through us, and our name becomes no more, essentially. And the job of all of us as Christian parents, I think, is to raise kids who do the same thing, make the same decision. That you forget our names in 100 years, but here we are in a church, and I couldn't tell you all the people who started, you know, the Fairfax congregation, for example, and yet here we are resting on the shoulders of their faithfulness. And so I have hope when I go to Hebrews and I see Jephthah's name in there, because I don't have to be remembered for my faith. My faith to be passed on from generation to generation comes from our children's ability to see Christ working through us. And Hebrews 11 also tells me that no matter what I've done to train wreck my life, Christ can work through me. And the last thing that's beautiful about Hebrews 11 here is even though God calls us to be faithful, he knows that we're going to be terrible at it. Is it kind of warming to your heart to know that you're going to be terrible at something that God wants to call you to, but he still wants to call you to it anyway? That's the God we serve. So, okay, read the story of Jephthah. Hopefully we can make some kind of peace with how terrible this story is, and we don't have to adjudicate what's right and wrong here, good and evil. Thankfully, we have a God who can redeem, even if our lives end up looking like Jephthah's. Oh, I also forgot to mention, how awesome is Jephthah's daughter's faith there? She seems like the real hero of this story. And if nothing else, the faith that Jephthah passed down to his daughter was, God is the most important thing in my life, even if my life didn't always show it. And Jephthah's daughter saw that, and the last thing that she wanted to do was to put anything between her father and her God. So, okay, what do we do with this? How do we avoid doing what's right in our own eyes, knowing that we're going to be terrible at it? And I don't have an answer for you so much as I have something that was on my heart that I'll share here. And something that happens a lot in the Gospels from Jesus is he tells us to be like children. Matthew 18:3 says, "Truly I tell you, unless you change and become like little children, you'll never enter the kingdom of God." And if we want to be kingdom folks and we have to be more like kids, well, let's think, what do kids do? Well, they ask a lot of questions, don't they? There's a research article published within the last year or two, and they sought to answer the question, how many questions does a child ask their parent every day? I didn't do too much research into the validity of this research, because some truths we declare self-evident. But on the low end of the spectrum, 9-year-old boys ask about 144 questions per day during the waking hours of the day, which is roughly one question every 5 to 6 minutes. On the other end of the spectrum is 4-year-old girls. 4-year-old girls ask on average 400 questions a day. That's one question every 2 minutes of their waking hours. And we learned from Phil last week, and from there's a lot of research supporting this, that the biggest indicator of whether a child is going to stay into the faith as they grow older is their parents' faith. And that makes sense because of statistics like this. Because the voice you hear most often is the voice you'll hear most clearly throughout your life. And you hear your parents' voice the most often. Your worldview is shaped by what your parents say to you and the actions that you observe them doing. And you see where this is going, right? So how do we connect with our Father with the same regularity as children? And look, I'm not trying to give you a checkbox of, well, I didn't ask God the last 5 minutes, I better do that now. But you see where I'm going. If we don't ask God more often, we are going to do things that are right in our own eyes more often instead, and we've seen where that leads. So, how do we become more like children? I decided to try and answer that question by asking my own children. They're there, they're handy. So I asked my own children, and in response, they mostly told me about bathroom humor, and so I had to go a different direction for this. So, object lesson time. Kids like object lessons, so we'll do that. So in this box here, I have a bunch of obsolete things that I no longer use anymore. And in this box of obsolete things, I have a webcam with a built-in microphone. Remember when you had to use those? What else we got? A point-and-shoot camera, 10 megapixels. Remember those, using that? All right, everyone, do it with me. I have a mix CD my friend made for me in college. Don't use that anymore. A Rand McNally Road Atlas. Remember these? I-66 and the Beltway are red on these lines, too. And then, these things all became obsolete when this happened. Yes. See, this is my first smartphone. It's a Motorola Droid, not an iPhone, because I'm in a lower tax bracket. But when this happened, all this stuff became obsolete, right? I can carry this with me. And I don't have to go to all these different resources to solve the things that I'm trying to solve. And here's the thing about object lessons, they're like a metaphor. Yes, I just use a simile to literally describe a metaphor. But a smartphone is kind of like what Jesus does for us when he came to this earth. We used to have to, as a people, we'd have to go to temples, we'd have to go to altars, we'd have to go to wise people to hear the word, to offer sacrifices, to connect with God in some meaningful way. But when Jesus came, now he's is accessible to us through his Spirit as information around the whole world is accessible to us now. The fullness of God lives within us every moment. But how often do we access them? In 2018, the average American adult spent 3 hours and 35 minutes a day on a smartphone. And look, I'm not trying to hate on these things. That argument's tired. These things aren't going anywhere. We got to deal with this, okay? If there's one thing I want us to take away from this object lesson, it's that if we want to do what's right in God's eyes instead of our own eyes, we have to connect with them more. Quantity, just straight up quantity. And if the next time you see your cell phone, that crosses your mind, that's the lesson then. What am I going, anytime I pull this out, well, not this one anymore, but you get what I'm saying. Anytime you pull out a smartphone, what are you asking? What are you trying to solve? You're going to make a decision, usually, or fill your mind with something to pass the time. When we pull out that phone, what if we think about what God wants to do at that time or that decision? You know, if I'm about to travel someplace and I pull out my GPS on my phone, well, God, I want you to direct my steps, and I want to know what you want me to do once I arrive in that destination. If you just want to fill your head and kill some time and you go on your social media or something, God, I want you to honor, I want to honor you with what I post or what I comment with. I'm not smart enough to know what divides people and what brings people together. When you text somebody or call somebody, God, thank you for putting that person in my life. I'm really seeing the ways that you're taking care of me, and I want to be your conduit to taking care of other people. There's 1,000 reasons we go to our phones every day, and if we have one more reason to think about God the next time we go for that phone, well, then that's the lesson. That's the lesson. Because with all the decisions that we make in any given day, we are at a very real risk of doing what's right in our own eyes and bringing catastrophe on the kingdom of God. Thank God that he can redeem it, but we need a king. We know what it's like, and we know what the world looks like when people do what's right in their own eyes, and we need a king to be involved in all of our decision-making if we are to have any hope of honoring him in our lives. And I know I've kind of been all over the place this morning, so let me throw up a conclusion slide here to try and bring it all together, and hopefully this made some sense. So number one, only with God can we discern what's good and evil. I know we're tempted to make that decision for him. I know people quote scripture, and Satan has even quoted scripture and has gotten it wrong, and we need God, and we need the Spirit of God to help us discern that scripture whenever we wield it. Number two, God can redeem his people under any circumstance. Praise God. Wherever you're at, no matter what you've done, if you've read any of the book of Judges, you know that you could fall into the category of being redeemed in Hebrews 11 based on what you saw in that book. Number three is just quantity of time with God. We must seek him frequently. Because if his is the voice that we hear the most often, his is the voice that we're going to hear in those moments of chaos, in those decision-making moments. And I love the last one. You're going to be awful at that. God knows you're going to be terrible at that, and he still chooses to redeem you, still chooses to redeem this church, still chooses to redeem all people on this earth. There's nothing outside of his ability. If you have any fear or if you have any consternation about what's going on in the world around us, it's not a result of God losing. It's a result of God's people making decisions for themselves instead of seeking God in their decision making. And that's a big problem that you and I can't take a huge bite out of, but we can do something in our day-to-day, in our moment-to-moment. And that's the lesson I want to leave you with. I'd like to pray for us, and then after the prayer, we'll have some singing, and if you guys want to become all stars in your faith and show up in Hebrews 11 and talk about the train wreck that you want God to work through, our elders will be up here and ready to receive you and pray over you, and we're here to rejoice with you as you share that with them. So let's pray together. Father, we acknowledge that we are unable to do what you do. And God, I ask that you search our hearts, the hearts of each person in here right now, and I pray that you reveal the areas of our lives where we are doing right in our own eyes. And as you reveal that, God, I just pray that you will invade that space instead, and that there's going to be one more moment in this day that we now give to you instead of we take ownership of. And God, may that be our story as Christ followers, that that journey is always undertaken by you to work on our hearts, to will and to act through us. God, I pray that we don't act out of fear or out of what's right in our own eyes. I pray that you will give us humility. And God, when we are sure that we've heard your voice, I pray that you'll give us boldness, especially for our leaders, especially here, our leaders at church, leaders of our families. Help us to hear your voice and know it's you because we heard it so often. Bless us as we give you more of our hearts, God, and it's through Christ we pray. Amen.
Please stand. You are good, you are good. When there's nothing good in me, you are love, on display for all to see. You are light, when the darkness closes in. You are hope, you have covered all my sin. You are peace, when my fear is crippling. You are true, even in my wandering. You are joy, you're the reason that I sing. You are life, in you death has lost its sting. And oh, I'm running to your arms, I'm running to your arms. The riches of your love will always be enough. Nothing compares to your embrace. Light of the world forever reign. You are more. go ahead and be seated. And if all the elders would go ahead and come on up, we're going to have an elders announcement.
We have a bunch of elders who are at the retreat this weekend, so looks a little short. I have a brief announcement to read, and we'll end our day with that. Good morning. On behalf of the elders, staff, and ministry coordination team, I want to take a few minutes to provide you with an update on the 2019 budget. As you've already seen this year, our theme of All In is guiding every aspect of our work here at Fairfax. A vital part of this is how we prioritize and use our budget. Here is how our all-in budget at Fairfax will look. Our goal for 2019 budget is to go all in on our mission to boldly show Jesus, to love God, and to love others. We're going to boldly show Jesus by continuing our outreach ministry activities, including programs like Friend Speak, English as a Second Language, Celebrate Recovery, and Distant Missions. Our discipleship ministries will continue to help us love God by pointing us to Jesus and strengthening our work in making disciples who make disciples through the support of our children, student, and adult ministries. We will continue to support our family life ministries that help us love others and take care of people and support the programs that grow the kingdom. Our coordination ministry that focuses on the building and systems will continue to support our other ministries. As you can see, this budget clearly demonstrates that we are all in both our faith and our works. Matthew chapter 17, verse 20, and he said to them, because of your little faith, for truly I say to you, if you have faith like a grain of mustard seed, and you will say to this mountain, move from here to there, and it will move, and nothing will be impossible for you. To make this possible takes both your prayers and support, but also manpower. The elders and staff recommend adding an outreach coordinator who will oversee all of our outreach efforts, both local and distant. The elders are in final review of the Vision Forward plans. We are praying, doing our homework, and earnestly seeking answers to the questions we still have. We are dotting the I's and crossing the T's to ensure that we understand the desired outcomes and potential impacts positive change can make on the congregation and the surrounding community. As reported last month, our 2018 budget ended with a surplus of $46,000. With these funds, the MCT and elders have pledged a one-time gift of $23,000 toward Billy and Fidella Strachan and their work in Scotland. The remaining funds are being prayed over, and no immediate expenditures have been determined. Instead, we want to hear what the Spirit may reveal to us in coming weeks and months. For the past 2 years, this church family has exceeded the challenges set forth by the elders related to our giving. And this year, we're renewing that challenge and asking you to be all in with us. Our 2018 budget was $1.29 million. This year we have set an annual giving goal of $1.33 million. This is a 2.5% increase in giving. Differently stated, last year's weekly goal budget was about $24,994. The new weekly budget amount is $25,627. We must also report that the current quarter has seen a significant downturn in our weekly giving. While several factors can be contributors to this, we want to challenge you and encourage you to continue your generosity. 2.5 is a small increase. to accomplish the things God has laid out for us in 2019. That is only $633 more a week than last year. Our ministries have managed their budgets well and have made cuts in an effort to be good stewards of the finances. But that small increase can do a tremendous things for the kingdom when our God is at the helm. We invite you to join us as we all go all in. Shall we pray? Father in heaven, we thank you so much for being with us this morning. We thank you for Joe's lesson and this message of following God no matter what it seems like, and we can't see the good outcome on the other side. Father, we pray that we will have faith such as the men that we heard about and women that we heard about in this lesson. Help us to follow you every day, starting with right now. As we go, we pray that you will bless us and keep us safe from the evil one. These things I ask through your Son's name. Amen.
You're dismissed.